The last thing that we're extremely grateful and delighted is to have Freeman Dyson with us this evening to introduce tonight's speaker. Freeman is a professor at the Institute for Advanced Study, so let's welcome him for the introduction.
Oh, thanks very much. No, I don't like long introductions, so I won't give you one. This talk should speak for itself. The main thing is don't lose the paperclips while he's talking. That's important. The best part of the talk is at the end when you play with the paperclips. So hang on to those and the scraps of paper that came with them. I've known Tadashi for, I guess, 14 years. He's a quite a unique figure. He's a really splendid mathematician, but also a scholar of languages. I first knew him, in fact, as mostly because he addressed me in seven languages, wishing me a happy new year. And he was also writing papers in several languages. He sent me some of his papers. One of them was called Tourbillon Dansant, Dancing Vortices, which is a lovely paper about how systems of vortices interact. And there was another paper called The Golfer's Dilemma, about how it can happen that a golf ball falls into a cylindrical hole and then jumps out again, and so on and so on. He has lovely ideas. Real math of the kind that I can appreciate, that is good old 19th century math, real problems. And in addition, of course, there's this amazing skill constructing and inventing toys. I don't need to talk about that because you'll see that for yourselves. Thank you.
Billions of people must drink from a cup every morning. One day, one of us started tapping the cup. It is the same pitch, more or less, wherever I tap. So maybe it's the signature pitch of this cup, so that if you take another cup, you get a different noise and so on. It's the same pitch. What you see then is that when I tap one of those four points, shown in green, I get the same sound from all over the cup. But then I started tapping somewhere else. You see, those four points emitted a single pitch. Those four points emitted a common pitch, but a higher pitch than those four points. What is going on? It's the question. When you tap those four points that are 45 degrees off, you get a higher, half a note this time, pitch. Well, thank you very much for pointing that out. I'm glad you said so. It has to do with the handle. But if it has to do with the handle, wouldn't you think, as I thought at first, that this half of the cup closer to the handle and this half farther from the handle should behave differently? But that's not how the symmetry is broken. Indeed, the point closest to the handle and farthest from the handle behave the same way, whereas 45 degrees off, you get the higher pitch. So what is causing this strange phenomenon? I think what's happening is as follows. First, let's forget about the handle. And you see, when you tap anything, it starts vibrating. It starts shaking. And let's say that I excited this point, and so it shakes back and forth. Well, the opposite point can do one of the two things, roughly speaking. It can do this, or it can do this. But this motion is really moving the cup back and forth as a whole rigid body, as a whole. So it doesn't deform the shape of the cup and therefore not involved in the production of the sound. What you're hearing, what has to do with the sound, is this response from the opposite point. But you see, the cup as a whole does not want to lose its volume. It wants to keep the same volume. So when those points go in reaction, these points get pushed out. And when these come in, these get pushed out so that you get this lozenge shape oscillation as a whole. That is why whichever point you excite, there are 90 degrees off, four points, a quadruplet of points that all work in unison, start working in unison. It doesn't matter which one of them you excite. That's why those four points emit the common pitch and those four points emit a common pitch. But now, why do those emit a lower pitch than those which emit a higher pitch? We now have to resurrect the handle. You see, when you excite any of those four points, they work in unison, as we said, they have to vibrate and they have to take the handle with them. You see, so you have this heavy handle that they must shake at the same time. But when you excite those four points, you remember that when this goes in, this comes out, this goes in, this comes out. And if you look at what the point in the middle is doing, to a good approximation, it's not moving. It is what we call a node. It does not move. So as far as those four points are concerned, this handle is as if it's not there. It's invisible. Now you have two elastic systems, if you like, springs you can think of with the same stiffness. One of them is attached to a heavy mass that they have to shake. That's the handle. And the other one, not attached to where the mass is relevant, and then you let them go. And what do you hear? The heavy one goes whoom, 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 in a sluggish way, and the lighter one goes hee-haw, hee-haw, and that's the difference of the pitch that you hear. Now, this is really exciting, and it's under our very noses every morning around the world, and yet you see this budding of science in our very presence. The other question is quite interesting. You see, so far we have been asking, well, we know this cup, we know where the handle is, and we just tap around and we want to understand what sound comes out. But let's invert the question. Let's invert the problem. Let's imagine that we walk into a dark room, completely pitch dark, since we're talking about the pitch. Pitch dark room, and we don't see anything. But we are allowed to, and we don't know where the handle is, but we are allowed to go around the cup, tapping this object all over the place and recording the sound pattern. Can you, from the recorded sound pattern, reconstruct where the handle is? In other words, from this observed data, can you sort of deduce what the cause is that is causing this observed data? That is called an inverse problem. And if you think about it, epistemologically, that's a big adverb that I managed to say, all of science is solving some sort of inverse problem often. So in this case, can we reconstruct where the handle is? And the answer is no, because you see, we get this bad sound pattern. But you agree with me readily that even if the handle were not here, but instead here, you would get the same pattern. Or for that matter, here, you would get exactly the same pattern. Or even more interestingly, instead of a single big handle, you could have two small handles here and here, or two small handles here and here, or four very small handles here and here. And you agree that at least what we call the grand state, in this lowest order, you hear exactly the same sound pattern. So you cannot tell the difference. You see, you don't know where the handle is, and you don't know how many handles there are. In other words, this inverse problem is not naively solvable. Nonetheless, up to symmetry, you can say something, and so on. So that's the first introduction. And as with most introductions to physical sciences nowadays, it is about vibration. It is about harmonic oscillator. Now we shall do something that is not so simple. We have, but the phenomenon is simple. The mathematics is much more exciting. So this is a tube, hollow tube, made of plastic, whose ends I have marked black and orange, orange and black colors of Princeton University, where I did my PhD. And I should get some funding from the Princeton Alumni Office for this. Anyway, I'm going to set this spinning by pressing down one end like this, and I'm going to spin it around the center. Because it's spinning around the center, a priori there should be no reason why we should see black better than orange or orange better than black. But now we shall try to spin this and see what we see. Which color do you see? I see black, don't you? I'm going to do that again. I see black spots. The resolution is not ideal, but I see black spots. So maybe we see black rather than orange, surprisingly, because the motion is completely symmetric around the middle. Maybe we see black rather than orange because black is a darker color. Orange, lighter color, so we see darker, better than light. But now, if I rub it against my shirt and launch it, you see, what do you see? I see orange. Huh? I see orange again. That's really interesting. Now, if I rub it against my black hair, you don't like orange? It becomes black again. Hey? What is going on? But if I rub it against my jeans, which is already black, well, nothing changes. It's still black. Well, with some audiences, I can keep going for hours and hours like this. So we have to understand what on earth is going on with this. So I'd like to begin by proposing a zeroth order theory, that is, really to approximate the roughest picture, which somehow captures the essence of the problem. But then you'll see that there are lots of things that are left, lots of stones that are left unturned, shall I say. So we have to understand it better. The first thing is a little bit of terminology. I'm launching this by pinching down on one end of the cylinder, on one end of the tube. So when I pinch it down, this cylinder starts spinning, but let's introduce a terminological distinction. Seen from above, this tube goes around the vertical axis, so to speak, and we shall call this big motion revolution. Okay? At the same time, because I'm giving this whole cylinder a backspin, so to speak, at this end, the cylinder also spins around its own axis of rotation, and we shall call that motion rotation. So we have two modes, two kinds of motions, revolution going around in sort of a horizontal direction, and the spin, which is the rotation, which is around its own axis. Okay. Now, please focus on the point which is at the other end of the tube. In other words, not the end that I pinched down, and see what happens. That end, you see, is going forward clockwise as seen from in this picture. No, sorry, counterclockwise as seen in this picture, forward because of revolution. But you see, at that end, the spin is a top spin because I pinched down with a back spin at the other end. You see, the whole thing is going around as the indicated by the diagram. So that's a top spin whose velocity is in the same direction as that of the revolution. So revolution and rotation add together, making that point work move very fast. In contrast, look at the end that I pinched down. Well, that end moves forward in the counterclockwise direction because of revolution as before. But unlike before, that end was given a backspin. So the rotational speed is in the opposite direction to the revolution speed. So they subtract from each other, the result being that that end moves slower. What we are seeing, you might have noticed, is that whichever end I press down, for example, black I press down, you see the black visible. And if I press down orange, having rubbed it against my shirt, you see orange. Whichever you press down, you always see. By the way, it doesn't matter whether black is at the top or black is sideways and so on. Which provided I press the black end, I always see black. And if I press down the orange end, wherever I press, it's always orange. So that's the rough approximation. Yes, you have a question.
It sounds like a stroboscopic effect.
Stroboscopic effect, the gentleman's question is, it sounds like a stroboscopic effect. But stroboscopic effect is an optical kind of illusion that if you do it under different lighting and so forth, or if you have different sort of camera capacity and so on, you'll see something different. But in fact, it's always the same. So you can do it in broader daylight, you can do it in so darker room, you can do it under. And in fact, if we had a much sort of faster camera, you'll see many other interesting things, but black or white, it's always the same. So it's not an optical effect, so to speak. Well, it's kind of optical because we are seeing this, but you'll see where that difference really comes from. Okay. But this does not quite explain everything we realize. And so now I'd like to give you the full story. In fact, it's as full as it's publishable, and it's been published in this exact form. So it's really as much science as we can do at this point. First, let's remark that when I press this, the motion of this thing in slow motion, if we can make it, is like this. You see the tube is tilted a little bit, and it's going around, 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 around in this kind of way. As it goes around, the point of contact of the tube with the floor describes a big circle, circle of revolution, if you like. And on that circle, this cross-sectional circle of the tube is, in some sense, rolling, if you like. Okay. Now, in the course of this motion, please, in your imagination, the tilt is constant, please, in your imagination, put from above, gently, a transparent ceiling. So as to sandwich this motion between the floor on the one hand and the ceiling on the other hand. So the tube is rolling, rolling, rolling in that gap between the floor below and the ceiling above, okay? Now, the tube is rolling on the floor. Well, there's an upside down symmetry between the floor and the ceiling. So if it's rolling on the floor, it's all rolling under the ceiling. What you see then is represented by this cartoon picture. This is the end of the tube, you see cross-section end of the tube, which is rolling under a ceiling like this. And there is a color point, which is marked. In this case, I use blue. I don't know why, because what university has blue as color? I don't know. Maybe Cambridge. That's why I use the blue. Anyway, so that's blue. And let's see how that blue dot moves as this end of the cylinder rolls under a ceiling, this imaginary ceiling that we put from above. Well, that motion has been analyzed by classical mathematicians, the kind that Freeman, Dyson, and I like, and it's called a cycloid. It describes this beautiful curve and then has a kink and then beautiful lobe and kink and keeps going. Poop, poop, poop. Now, if you imagine driving along this kind of road, at each kink, you drive in, but you have to back out. And in order to reverse, you have to stop instantaneously. There's no way out. Yeah? So this motion actually has a stopping point at each of those kinks. But those kinks are exactly sort of spiky things that are pointing upward, facing us, the observers or the camera that are looking at the motion from above. So at each time, in other words, the colored point faces up, it stops instantaneously. I said something earlier to the effect that the end that we are seeing goes slower than the end that we are not seeing. But never mind slow. In fact, each time the spot faces up, it stops. As this is the cartoon picture, again, as the cylinder or the tube rolls around and around, the tilt is exaggerated, describing a large circle below and large circle above. That above circle is the ceiling circle. The spot is going along the cycloid, a number of lobes hanging from above, and each time it faces up, we are looking at it from above, it stops there. Puff, 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 instantaneously. That's why we see those spots so clearly, and that's why we see those black spots. And orange spots. And depending on which side you start from. Okay. This involved a lot of what we call nonlinear analysis. There was a rolling, there was interesting coupling where you are not supposed to slide and so on. And you saw this curious pattern emerging from the first experiment with sound to nonlinear, so linear motion to nonlinear motion. Now, we have been playing with toys that have only one component, you know, cup, cylinder. We would like to go into toys that have multiple components. In other words, we want to increase the number of objects that are interacting during the in the course of the phenomenon. Here is a soup bowl that borrowed from the Cambridge University cafeteria. And on the other hand, little box. I don't know if you can see what's written on the cover. Chai Gruzinski Extra, it says, extra Georgian tea. And if you open it, there's, again, too much reflection, but the kak zavarivat chai, how to brew the best quality of tea. So there's a scientific instruction as to how to make your tea. And that has nothing to do with the experiment. I'm just carrying around cedar balls inside. And one thing that can be said for this experiment is that it smells nice. I mean, what? You know, about how many other experiments can you say such a thing? Now, if you put three cedar balls and then swirl the soup bowl, you can see that the theta balls circulate in the same direction that I'm swirling, in the same direction. Well, that's not surprising. But now, let's increase the number of theta balls. Let's increase the crowdedness. Then when I swirl, they start going in the opposite direction. Can you see that? So there was a transition from the circulation in the right direction, circulation in the wrong direction. If you have one ball or two or three, we have already seen, they circulate in the usual direction, I mean reasonable direction. Four and five, there is a lot of, and six, there's a lot of hesitation, but at seven, they seem to start going backwards, and at eight, they're still going backwards, and so on. What is happening here is a toy model, I would like to suggest, of what is called a phase transition. In other words, you know, when you take H2O, it can be vapor, but condenses into water, liquid water, and water freezes the ice. So in the other direction, if the temperature rises, the ice melts to water, and water evaporates to vapor, and so on. The same substance, but depending on the external conditions. In this case, temperature, but in our case, crowdedness, different thing, qualitatively different phenomena start occurring. Well, so what are the physical mechanisms behind? What's really going on? Well, what's going on is that when you have not too many balls, you see those balls are what we call independent particles. They don't really talk to one another. They don't collide with one another too much. So what is driving the motion is that the, as you swirl, the wall keeps hitting on the balls and sends the ball in the direction that you are swirling. No problem. It's a very natural phenomenon. It's a momentum-driven motion in the sense that each time the wall hits, it imparts momentum to the balls. Suppose, however, that I increase the number of balls and make them more crowded. Then you see whatever momentum comes in from the wall gets scattered among the contacts between neighbors. So that's wasted. But what is not wasted and what takes over is that the wall now rubs against each ball. And this rubbing makes each ball rotate, and rotation is transmitted neighbor from neighbor to neighbor. We have now an angular momentum-dominated regime from the initial linear momentum-dominated regime. So there's a change in the dominant mechanism, and that is why you see this kind of strange phenomenon. So it is, in fact, a little like, on a toy level, phase transition from vapor to liquid, because you see, when you have gas, you have more or less free particles moving around, minding their own businesses. But when you have liquid, well, the molecules can slide past each other. They have some freedom, but they are still constrained. You know, they are nonetheless constrained to interact neighbor-wise. To show you that it is really like phase transition, if you keep increasing the number of balls, then the system freezes solid. You see, it's really like that. Okay. That was a transition from one direction to another direction. I'd like to insert a comic relief here. And I'm not going to explain anything. In fact, I'm not sure that I can explain anything in this case. Nut and bolt, very loosely fitted together, and the cheapest electric toothbrush that I could find in Princeton several months ago. And when I get going, I'm sorry that this end spins back and forth, but that's a red herring. In fact, you can have a much simpler toothbrush which vibrates back and forth, that works perfectly fine. Now, when I press this toothbrush against the bolt, it's going to make the whole thing vibrate. But there is no reason why the rotational symmetry should be broken. I mean, it's not going to start spinning one way or the other, because after all, I'm just pressing this vibration, and then I'm making it vibrate. Yeah? But if I channel my mysterious oriental energy into this, I can make the whole thing go one way, or you think that it's just going one way because it always goes one way, or come back the other way. But I can make it go one way. I have to concentrate doing this. Go forward, forward, forward. And it's going against gravity, mind you, so much that you can do it. Yes, yes, yes. I can take it off. It's amazing that you can do such a thing. And these secrets will not be revealed for free. Well. After that, let's now explore an even more exciting class of phenomena. So far, we have seen
oscillations and rotations, some very interesting nonlinear rotations in some sense, and then you know, transition from one kind of physics to another kind of physics, one kind of mathematical mechanism to another kind, but that was always within the same system. Now, I'd like to start talking about really serious things that can happen and which challenge the imagination of the scientists. Now, can I see? Ah, here it is. Okay, and how should I see this? Maybe like this. Ah, here it is. Okay. Good. Okay. Those two heptagons, sevengons, were given to me. Oh, by the way, I should have mentioned that the this seedables in the swirling dish experiment was discovered by Rehberg and was studied by Palfima Hore and so on. And so, wonderful study. And this next toy was given to me as a present by Andy Ruina of Cornell University. Those are heptagons, or sevengons. And I can guarantee that they're made of the same material. And also, they have the same surface coating. Moreover, they have the same mass. And finally, something that I have to say, a bit complicated, but please follow me. The mass distribution is exactly like the volume distribution. And the compact way of saying it is that the density of mass is constant within each. In other words, I'm not hiding anything. What you see is exactly how the mass is distributed. I'm not, for example, hiding a hollow inside, or it's not that the more mass is concentrated near the spoke and so on. There's none of that. What you see is exactly what you are getting. Okay. Nonetheless, when you try to roll one of them, it rolls very, very with alacrity, whereas the other one refuses to roll. The difference is quite striking. Nonetheless, if you look at one on top of the other, they look exactly the same. You can't really see the difference. And yet, one rolls so easily, and the other one, impossible, practically impossible to. So what is the difference, apart from my untrustworthy nature? Hey? Yes? You can take a guess, yes? Let's take a guess. Ah, maybe there's something magnetic, or maybe something is hidden under the table and so on. There's none of this. I can do this. But the table must be very hard. One of them, which rolls, is not, in fact, a heptagon, regular heptagon. It is a regular heptagon whose edges, or the sides, have been slightly bulged out, rounded. That's the one that rolls, whereas the one that does not roll is a straight heptagon. Why does that matter, and why does the hardness of the support table matter? This picture depicts the rounded version, and the roundedness is slightly exaggerated. You see, when you have a slightly rounded heptagon, polygon, and it wants to roll, it can, because as it wants to roll, starting from one corner to the next corner, in between, you can transit by a continuous smooth transition of this contact point. As the whole thing rolls, you get the contact point going from one corner to the next corner continuously. So there is no loss. There is no bad catastrophe. And this is true however small epsilon is. In fact, in practice, for those two heptagons, the epsilon, this bulged out, this tiny, tiny difference is of the order of 0.1 millimeter. And I hope, do you speak metric? Anyway, 0.1 millimeter. And if you think that this diameter is about 10 centimeters, it's 1 in 1,000 difference. Yeah? So it's 0.1 percent difference. It's a tiny, tiny difference, and yet it's capable of producing such a dramatic qualitative difference in the behavior. And that's true for whatever small epsilon. But suppose now that the epsilon is exactly zero, that's the non-rolling one, that's when you have a straight edge. In that case, you see there's a catastrophe, because as the polygon wants to roll, effectively has to pivot around one of the corners. As it wants to go to the next corner, there is no point of contact. The entire edge is in levitation, in midair. And it sort of leans over. There's no point of contact, no point of contact, until bang, it crashes. The next corner crashes onto the floor, dissipating the energy and killing the motion. And that's what happens when epsilon is zero. We are in the presence of one of the most challenging situations in mathematical sciences called singular perturbation. You see, often when you want to model a situation, model a phenomenon, problem, that phenomenon, that model has a parameter. In this case, epsilon, the roundedness. And you might say, well, when epsilon is 0.1, it does one thing. 0.01, it does the same thing. 0.001, it does the same thing. 0.0001, it does the same thing. And OK, that's always the same thing. And you are tempted to conclude that when epsilon is zero, it does the same thing. But surprise, it doesn't. There's a discontinuity in the prediction of the model as you take the limit of epsilon going to zero. The most famous example, perhaps, in the mathematical sciences is that of Navier-Stokes equation in the motion of viscous fluid. We shall come back to something like that later on, where when you take the limit as the viscosity, this gooiness of the fluid goes to zero, the prediction of the model is that more and more mess happens, turbulence. But when epsilon is zero to begin with, you get this idealized theory called the inviscid flow, and often you get the very beautiful lamina, no messy pattern, and so forth. So you get, but this is perhaps the world's smallest number of degree of freedom example that has been discovered so far of this kind of singular perturbation, which is naturally realizable. Now, since we are talking about heptagons, I'd like to insert a little digression also. I learned that in some countries I have to insert a commercial every once in a while. And here is a strip of paper that I'm going to show. And I'd like to show you how to make regular polygons. You see, you learn in Euclidean geometry with ruler and compass that you can draw an equilateral triangle, maybe a regular pentagon and so forth. But not all regular polygons can be drawn with ruler and compass. But anyway, drawing with ruler and compass regular polygons is quite difficult. I'd like to share with you a foolproof method. First, I'm going to start with a regular pentagon. Take a strip of paper, and all I do is simply to make tie a little knot, the simplest that you can imagine. Now, I tighten the knot, and as I tighten the knot, I flatten the knot. I tighten and flatten, and delicately tighten and flatten. I'm not doing anything, but I'm letting paper make all the decisions. And finally, when it's completely flat and tight, you get this. In order to show you what happened, I'm going to throw away the parts that are sticking out. And what you have obtained in the middle, in fact, by this automatic procedure of origami, if you like, is a regular pentagon. I didn't do anything. I just knotted and tightened. The same thing works if you make a little generalization. You see, when we started, we made one pass to make the simplest knot. In some sense, make two passes to make a slightly more complicated knot and tighten, tighten, tighten. What comes out automatically turns out to be a regular sevengon, regular heptagon. And if you make three passes, regular ninegon. You can guess what you need to do in order to get the regular 11gon and so on. All the same. These are all odd gons, but once you have a regular polygon with an odd number of edges, well, you can always divide angles into two, doubling the number of sides is easy, so you can get all the even ones as well. You might say, however, well, wait a minute, so when we made one pass, we already started from five. How can I make, with origami, tying a knot, a regular trigon, that is an equilateral triangle, three? Well, if you follow this pattern, you have to make a zero pass. And that's the picture that you have. In order to show you that this really is successful, I would like to show off to you a regular 11-gon that I made. And this is not possible to draw with ruler and compass, according to a theorem in Galois theory. And you see that starting from here, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 edges is a regular
11 gone, and you just keep going around and around. And it is kind of delicate, by the way, but you tighten and flatten, and you automatically get regular n gone for all n, thanks to this device. That was the digression. Let's now move on from those singularities, singular perturbation, to something even more serious from the mathematical point of view, but very easy to do in terms of the experiment in daily life. That's what we'd like to explore. Every once in a while, you run into people who happen to be carrying around an inclined plane, and here I have brought a jar full of basmati rice from India and another jar full of a nice air from Manhattan. And so one of them is full and the other one is empty. Let's call them 1 and 0. And what we would like to do is to let them roll down this, that's the full one, excuse me. Let them roll down this inclined plane. Okay. Now, they roll down quite fast, don't they? I mean, sophisticated people in the audience will say not exactly the same because moment of inertia is doing something, but pretty fast and more or less at the same speed. So what I would like to do is to study how the descent pace of descent depends on the amount of stuff in the jar. In other words, how does the pace depend on the filling? When it's 1 and 0, we have seen that it goes down quite fast, more or less at the same speed. But what happens if I take, say, something that is only partially full? So this is about two-thirds full. Do you think that it will go down faster or slower? How does it depend? Well, in this case, there are three possibilities a priori. Maybe it will go down faster than 0 or 1. Maybe this two-thirds one will go down slower than 0 or 1. Or maybe, if you believe in that story of Galileo dropping two unequal masses from the Tower of Pisa, and hopefully there was nobody underneath, and falling at the same rate, then you say, well, it doesn't depend on the amount of stuff inside, it will go down at the same rate. So let's take a vote. Who thinks that this two-thirds jar, a partially full one, will go down faster than 0-1? Who thinks? Who thinks it will go down slower than 0-1? That's the option that most reasonable people go for. And who thinks it will go down at the same rate as 0-1? Okay, let's try. I'm going to start doing. Okay, are you ready? Oop. It goes down very, very slowly. Huh? But not only does it go down very slowly, there's a lot happening inside the jar. I'll describe, because the camera may not show it completely, that inside the jar, there is a sort of landslide. You see, the grains are only partially full. And while the grains are sort of in the inside of the body, so to speak, and they're stuck to each other, they don't slide on the interior surface of the cylinder, of the jar. But when they emerge, thanks to the rotation, on the free surface, top surface, then they avalanche down, they landslide, and then lose a lot of energy and so forth. So this is a very curious behavior. In a nutshell, scientists will say that these grains are behaving a bit like viscous fluid. In other words, ordinary fluid that you see, it doesn't slip along the solid boundaries, but on the surface there's a lot of freedom and it can sort of do all sorts of wavy patterns and so on. We shall come back to that, but in the meantime, let's explore the other case, the complementary case. This is about one-third full, perhaps. And now, how will this go down compared with the previous experiments? Well, there are now four possibilities, aren't there? Perhaps it will be the champion, and it's faster than all of the above. Or it will be the slowest, yeah? Slower than even the 2000 one. Or you might say, well, it will be faster than 2000, which was pretty slow, but slower than 1 and 0, which were pretty fast. Or if you have a beautifully symmetric mind, mathematicians often do, there might be a symmetry between F and 1 minus F, one-third and two-thirds. Depending on your optimism, it's one-third empty or two-thirds full. So maybe it's going to go down exactly at the same rate as two-thirds. So who thinks it will go down the fastest? It's a champion, fastest. Who thinks it will be the slowest? Slowest. And who thinks it will go faster than two-thirds, which is pretty slow, but slower than 1 and 0? That's the one that most reasonable people go for. And who thinks that it will go down at exactly the same rate as the two-thirds? One-third and two-thirds the same. Ah, no takers. And who, okay, thank you very much. Who is too shy to vote? And okay, good. So let's try this. That's the one-third.
and nothing up this sleeve and nothing up this sleeve. Are you ready? We shall go. Oop. Ah, it stops completely dead. And in fact, it's so zero that when I try to coax it go forward, it really refuses to move, which is quite remarkable. Why does it not move? I mean, there are grains there, and gravity is pulling downwards, and it doesn't want to move. It's amazing stuff. So we'd like to understand at least why it stopped altogether. And the reason has to do with a common experience that we all had when we went to the beach. We are asking, why does a jar almost full slow down, and why does a jar almost empty stop altogether? When you go to a beach and want to make a sand pile, mountain of sand, it had better be dry sand, by the way, because with wet sand you can do all sorts of strange things, but with dry sand, and you want to make the pile as steep as you can, but you see there's only so much steepness you can get. If you make the pile too steep, the pile landslides, avalanches, and settles to a certain angle. Yeah, that's the experience. You can get a maximum amount of steepness, but no more. And that's determined by properties of the sand. That angle, the maximum angle of the steepness, is called the angle of repose by the professionals. By the way, for liquid, however viscous, for example, honey, maple syrup, what have you, you might try to make a pile of liquid. But if you wait long enough, it's going to settle to a completely flat surface. So we can say that for liquid, the angle of repose is zero. Now, this is the case of an almost full jar. And let's see what happens. You see, an almost full jar, because it's almost full, has the property that the center of gravity of the sand, or the grains, or the rice in this case, whatever grains you have, is more or less in the middle. And that gravity pulling down at the center of gravity is indicated by the green arrow. At the same time, perhaps it's a bit small, but I indicated the point of contact between the jar and the slope in red. That red dot is the point of contact. You see in this picture that when the grains are quite voluminous, I mean, there's a lot of grains, the center of gravity is on the downhill side of the point of contact, so that the gravity pulling down has the effect of rotating the whole jar around the point of contact in the clockwise direction. That's the direction that helps the descent. Yeah? In contrast, if you don't have too many grains inside, then you can arrange matters so that the center of gravity is on the uphill side, amazingly, of the point of contact, as shown here. The green arrow is to the left of the red dot, which is the point of contact. In that case, the effect of gravity, which is, mind you, pulling down, is to rotate the whole jar in the counterclockwise direction, that is the direction that fights against descent. So you can stop the descent by this mechanism. This kind of thing happens only because alpha, the angle of repose, is greater than beta, the angle inclination of the, of the slope. So what we see then is the following surprising result, that if you want to plot as a graph the descent pace, pace of descent, against how much stuff there is in the jar, that is filling how full, at 0% and 100%, you descended quite fast, so those points are quite high up. But somewhere in the middle, there's a whole basin of immobility, zero speed strictly, somewhere in the middle. Stop completely. It's interesting, however, to step away from this basin of immobility. You see, when we go to the right of this basin, namely, if you go slightly towards 100%, well, this stuff, the jar started rolling again. That was the, you know, the experiment with two-thirds. It rolls. And do you remember how it rolled? It rolled with a lot of landslide inside and a lot of motion inside and the whole body of grains was behaving like a viscous fluid, gooey fluid. What if we step off the basin of immobility to the left? After all, if we go towards zero, I mean, when the jar becomes empty, it starts rolling again. So it had better start rolling again, to be sure, slowly. But the way it starts rolling, the motion is resurrected, is quite remarkable. I'd like to show you how that works. Here is a jar with very, very few grains left. And let's see how it rolls down. And note the contrast with the almost full case. It goes down. And I don't know if you can see, but now all the grains are sliding inside a jar. There's no avalanche. There's no landslide. The whole grains are just going stick, slip, stick, slip, slightly oscillating, but it goes down. Completely different kind of motion. So what you are seeing is that when you step to the right, you see this kind of very complicated avalanche and sticky interior and so on. That's the behavior of a viscous fluid. Whereas if you go to the left, it starts moving also, but that motion has a completely different characteristic. And that is the whole grains are sliding back and forth, and there is no avalanche on the surface. And that is how an inviscid, that is fluid devoid of viscosity, would behave. You remember the discussion about epsilon positive and epsilon not, epsilon exactly equal to zero with those rolling and non-rolling polygons? Well, in fluid mechanics, which is one of the most beautiful but most difficult mathematical subjects that there is, also experimentally difficult, well, this dichotomy is known to be very serious. On the one hand, there is a great model of viscous fluid. On the other hand, there's a classical and very beautiful model of inviscid fluid. But those two models are pretty much incompatible. Among other things, in the viscous fluid, you're supposed to stick along solid boundaries. In the inviscid flow, you're supposed to slide along boundaries. But nonetheless, here we have an example, probably the only one that is so cleanly physically reproducible in the world and so easy, of a phenomenon where those two mathematically incompatible regimes are living together. To be sure, separated by this basin of immobility. Now you can guess what the experimental challenge is, what the next step in research is. We want to play with this system so that this basin of immobility becomes narrower and narrower and narrower, and eventually forcing this inviscid regime on the left and viscous regime on the right to meet. And then Mother Nature will have some really hard decision making to do. And that's what we would like to see. OK. I would like to end with one example, which is work in progress. And also, it comes from a very traditional toy of my home country, and that is this object. That's a paper balloon, but paper made of really crunkly material. The way you are supposed to play with it is that you see there's a hole, so you blow into the hole, make it round, and then you play with it. And in fact, once it's round, it's quite bouncy. There's an effective bounciness. By the way, there's no, you know, it's not airtight. There is a hole, but it's quite bouncy. Okay. But I noticed that there is another way to expand this, inflate this balloon. I can crumple it, and then I start hitting it. You have to be a little patient with me, because it will take a minute or so. Now, when you keep hitting on something, don't you have the impression that you'll make it smaller and smaller because you're hitting it? And when you are denting something, you certainly should not make it rounder and rounder, right? But look, I keep hitting it in a completely random manner. And what's happening to this? I'm trying to dent it at each hit. And the result is that it's become spherical. We have discovered a way of making something round by denting it. What? This is quite remarkable. Now, I cannot do this for lack of time, but I've done something even worse, or even more interesting, depending on your point of view. You know, I did the same thing at home, but first hitting it sideways on the floor in order to eliminate the effect of gravity. But what is really worse is that instead of sort of cupping it and hitting it with my palms, I hit it with my fingers all over the place. Now, that's surely going to dent it, but after 30 minutes of really patient work, it started getting rounder, rounder, and it became completely round. And once it's round, you can hit it, and it stays round. Remarkable situation. So how does it happen? And this, I would like to suggest, is connected. Well, I'm speculating, because I haven't really worked this out, with something called inverse cascading. It is now time to bring this presentation, this talk, to a halt, and to some conclusion. In the course of our time together, we have seen an enormous range of natural phenomena and accompanying mathematics. You know, chiming teacup to spinning tube to swirl circulation goes one way or the other way, wrong way sometimes, transition, and electric toothbrush made a brief appearance, and then rolling, not rolling, and jars of grain, and then paper balloons, and so on. And on the right column, you see those deep mathematical sort of concepts that we only partially understand emerging, popping up and down, which in fleeting manners, which we sometimes understand and sometimes not. When we talk about science, we think about science, we have the impression that science is practiced by really dignified professors, and yours truly excepted, you know, probably wearing a lab coat, white lab coat, and in a big university lecture room, surely wearing polished shoes, and, you know, in huge laboratories or expensive equipment, probably looking at supercomputers and so on. And the knowledge is perhaps stored on the internet and big textbooks and monographs and perhaps journals, and the management of which requires big, you know, research grants and cutting-edge proposals and so on. So these are all very important, and of course that's how we organize science as a society. But against this background then, we have to ask, and this is a natural point to ask, why are we playing with toys? In a manner of hint to a response, I'd like to narrate an anecdote from a relatively little known book of Aristotle called De Partibus Animalium. Aristotle talks about Heraclitus, who was a great natural philosopher in Greece. About 600 BC, he flourished. You know, he was a celebrity of kind at the time, and, you know, big science, mediatic celebrity. And Aristotle tells of the time when two young people came to see Heraclitus, and they were probably expecting to see a big professor, you know, in lab coat and in an enormous laboratory and looking at supercomputers, what have you. But then, when they arrive, they see something different. They find Heraclitus in a completely different way. Aristotle says, in all natural phenomena, there is something of the marvelous. There is a story that some visitors once wished to meet Heraclitus. And when they entered and saw him in the kitchen, warming himself at the stove and probably playing with the children, they hesitated. But Heraclitus said, "Come in, don't be afraid. There are gods even here. Enaigar kai entautha theus." To all of you who took the time this evening to come explore those toys, the budding of science with us, and especially to the staff, helpful staff of MoMath and Freeman Dyson, who kindly gave the introduction, thank you very much. Now, according to the management of MoMath, I'm supposed to go straight to the activity session. But if you would like to go where, as we say in German, where even kings must go on foot, please feel free to do so. Here we need the strip of paper. And the paper clips, and in a moment, some rubber bands. But first, we can do with paper strip and two paper clips. I'd like to share with you a magic trick, but you're probably beginning to understand what I mean by magic and what I mean by toys. You know, it's quite curious that magicians, professional magicians, don't want to give away their secret. Okay, maybe it's not curious. But there exists, it turns out, a very special brand of magic where all the secrets can be given away. And yet, even after the secrets are known, the magic itself is quite amazing. And moreover, unlike the magician's magic trick, you don't have to have special skills. Provided you are careful and patient, it works for everyone. There is a special brand of magic tricks like this. Isn't that weird? Magic tricks whose secrets can be given away, and yet they continue to be amazing, and they continue to provide more magic tricks. There is a name for such a brand of magic tricks, and it is called science. So I'd like to show you a bit of science, but also a magic trick that you can share with friends and family. First, take this paper strip. By the way, when you do this, you'll see that paper strip can be a little narrower, but OK. And so paper strip, and please bend it into an S shape like this. And with the help of the paper clips that you have, if you have lost your paper clips or want more, there are, I think, volunteers who will give you. So just raise your hands. And with the help of those paper clips, please fix that S shape. So I do this, and I do that. You might be wondering whether the orientation or the direction in which the paper clips are slotted in matters, but in fact, they don't. I've designed it so that everything is robust. By the way, what we are about to do is a classical trick, which goes back quite a long while. I found an English reference in Martin Gardner's Encyclopedia of Impromptu Magic. I think it's from the early 80s or so. But also a Japanese engineer, Kako Satoshi, a very, very imaginative person, writing about this from the 70s. But we'll see some non-classical things in a moment. But first, the zeroth version is the classical one. So are you all together? Are we together? This is what we should have. That, yeah? Not yet? OK, so paperclip capably just fixing this curvy serpentine shape. Now, what happens if I start pulling the ends of the paper? Well, you can see that the paperclips come closer and closer together because they are driven by the paper, and eventually they'll touch and jam. But if you keep pulling, what happens is that they hop. And please pick up the paper clips. They are linked together. Hey? So this is quite remarkable. And that's the classical zeroth one that I mentioned. You just bend the paper in this S kind of shape and then put paper clips together and pull the ends. And the paper clips come out linked. So if my career does not work out, we'll all together start a factory that connects paper clips together. Now, that's the zeroth version. I would like to now explore some variations. The first variation is exactly the same preparation as before, as far as the paper and paper clips are concerned, but we add a rubber band. Let me show you the final product, and then I'll suggest how to make it. This is what you would like to get. So you have exactly the same configuration of paper and paper clips, you notice. But there's a rubber band hanging here, as you see from above. Please note that there are two loops. And this rubber band is hanging on this loop rather than on the other loop. Yeah. Now, how do we make this? This is one suggestion. You can probably make it yourself. First, just hook the rubber band on the paper, and then make this pattern. Just trap the rubber band in this loop. You know what I'm doing? So, yeah? And then I'm going to close the other flap and then fix that flap with the paper clip as before in the version zero. Okay. And so this is what happens. Are we together? More or less? We shall call this version, version A, yeah? Because there'll be soon version B. But version A is this. So you have, as seen in this, on the screen, I'm holding it, and there is this and this, and it's hanging here. Now, when you pull, please pull, what happens is that. Don't let the paper go, and it all ends up hanging from the paper. That's very curious. The rubber band stayed on the paper, followed by those two paper clips hanging from the rubber band. So this is what happens. And you get this kind of a half chain. Yeah. And this is what happens. OK. But you know, in science, sometimes you have to exercise observation. You cannot dismiss as irrelevant small differences of innocuous appearance. And so let's try something else, which looks like the previous one, but not quite is the same thing. And what I mean is the aforementioned version number 2. I'll first show you what I mean This was version number one that we have just tried. Okay? Yes? Now, I shake it in my back. And then, this is version number two. You see, the rubber band used to hang here, but now it's migrated here. You know what I'm doing? So I'm going to make another one so that we can contrast version number one, version number A and version number B. Version A that we tried was this one. And B that we are trying is this one. It's more or less the same thing. But the position of the rubber band is different. Can you make this? Now, in the previous session, I discovered that it's far too confusing to explain this. So it's explain how to make it. So please try to make it the way you find comfortable. But do you see the difference between A and B? What we're trying to do is the left one, the B. So we don't want this. We want this. We don't want the right. We want the left. So this is what we would like to have. Sorry. OK, are we ready? OK, now you remember what happened to version A, the previous one. The whole rubber band and clip were left hanging on the paper strip. This time, the whole thing comes off. So it's different. Nonetheless, this chain of clip rubber band is still present. So version A stays on the paper, whereas version B falls off the paper. You know, I'd like to debunk myself, because that's far too much mystery. And I'd like to at least explain why in version A, the rubber band stays on the paper, and B, it falls off the paper. Let's forget about the clips. In fact, the clips are the most interesting things. But as far as the rubber bands are concerned, there is no mystery in the rubber band staying on the paper in A and falling off the paper in B, it turns out. Because of this, please watch. That was the position of the rubber band in version number A. Yeah, you remember? And please see how the paper is positioned with respect to the rubber band. You see, the paper goes through the rubber band and then just goes on the side. So when I pull the ends of the paper, the rubber band is linked with the paper, as we say. So it has no choice but to stay on the paper. In contrast, the position of version B was like this. It was here. And you see what the paper does? Paper goes in but comes back out from the rubber band. So when I pull the ends of the paper, rubber band is not linked to the paper, so it can fall down. Thus, there is no mystery in rubber band staying on the paper in version number A because it's linked to the paper and falling off in B because it's unlinked to the paper. But as I said, the action of the paper clips is quite interesting. Going back to where we came from, having seen version A, which stays on the paper, and version B, which fell off the paper, it becomes tempting, indeed irresistible, to superpose them. In other words, what's one A plus B? What happens if I do both at the same time? And you will readily agree that what we mean by A plus B should look like this. So that's, I think, what naturally should be A plus B. Here it is. Do you see that? I think it's A plus B. That's the only natural choice for A plus B because, you see, this rubber band by itself is in the A position. This rubber band by itself is in the B position. And you remember that A stayed on the paper, and you can see that because the paper goes in and links with the rubber band and comes out, whereas B, paper goes in but comes back out, so this is unlinked to the paper. Now what's going to happen if you play the same trick with the paper clips? What do you think will happen? We have seen A, which had the rubber band on the paper with two paper clips hanging, B, clip rubber band, but everything fell down. What do you think happens if we do both at the same time? Yes, that's too beautiful to be true, but of course that's what happens. That's exactly what happens. You get this long chain of band, clip, clip band, everything hanging from the paper. One of the rubber bands must stay on the paper because that was the A band linked to the paper. The other one fell off the paper because it's the B band unlinked to the paper, and then both are linked with the paper clips. Okay. Now, before we say goodbye and then go to the questions and so on, I'd like to show you, as usual, one little maneuver in research progress. I haven't quite perfected it. So far, we have been adding paper clips, if you see what I mean. Yeah? We have been linking paper clips, and that's like addition. I began to think, well, can we do subtraction? What the hell does that mean? Well, it should mean that instead of linking unlinked paper clips together, I start from two linked paper clips and have this foolish ambition to unlink them. Yeah? And here, the orientation turns out to be quite important. So please watch that, ascertain that these two paper clips are linked already, and I'd like to unlink them. What I do, I haven't practiced before I came to Monmouth, so please forgive me if I end up tearing the paper, but this is, again, research in progress. So I'm just bend the paper as usual, and then, this is not quite what I would like to do. So what do I want to do? Yes, I want to do, no, not this. I think I want to do this. The orientation is mysteriously important. Come on. Yeah. So I think that's what it is. Is that what it is? Yes, I think that's what it is. Okay, so I bend the paper, and I put this linked pair in such a way as to straddle over those two loops. You see, there are two loops, and I put one clip in one, and I put the other clip in other, but otherwise they are linked, those paper clips are linked. Yes? Here, that's more or less what I do. This might be difficult to do because I haven't explained what orientation to take. It turns out that there are not so many different orientations that you can try. All of them will end up miserable failure. They'll end up tearing your paper, but one of them does what I'm hopefully about to show you. When I pull, you see those were linked. When I pull, look, they got unlinked. Now we can subtract. I hope you had a great time, and please share.
Let's hear a big hand for Professor Tokieda.
Thank you.
So if you have any questions about addition or subtraction of paper clips, or about any other topics from earlier in the in tonight's presentation, here's how it works. You raise your hand, you wait till I run to you with the mic, you wait for the mic, and you say your question to the mic. But I, tonight, am going to use the power of having the mic in my hand to ask the first question,
yes.
And then I'll turn it over to you. And here's the first question, yes. Professor Tokieda. I detect something that feels to me like a little bit of a gap in the red and black cylinder spinning, which is that you showed to us how the end of the cylinder that is spinning around up in the air is the one we should see the color on that end.
Yes.
Yet when you push down onto the table with one of the colors, that's the color that we see.
That's
now
right.
Intuitively, it would seem that the one I push down should be the one that's spinning on the table and the other end should lift up in the air. Why does the one that I push down end up being in the air?
Not too long ago, when I started in science, I learned that when I cannot answer a question, I should compliment it. It is an excellent question. Well, in this case, however, the question is, how come, you know, I pressed down one end, but the other end, instead of going up, goes down, and the end that I pressed down goes up? What on earth is going on? Well, this is slight, I haven't found a good intuitive, shall I say, explanation, but it's in fact not difficult to see from rigid body dynamics. It's something called a gyroscopic effect. So if you look at all the forces and so on, you can actually show that when you press down, that thing must go up and start rotating. But I haven't found really a good, well, I have found one demo, which is this demo itself, but I haven't found a really good way to answer the question, I'm sorry. But it can be done. In some sense, you see, this is what happens. Of course, you know, we try to understand and discover new phenomena and connect to new ones and so on. Sometimes you do experiments, sometimes you do simulation, and sometimes you do mathematics. And mathematicians have their own intuition. I do too. But sometimes you feel that what you are doing is just calculate, keep track of things, and then the answer comes out. But you are no wiser. Somehow mathematics did the work, and you happen to have the skill for mathematics. So it's like diving into the mathematical sea, and when you emerged, you had a fish under your arm, and I didn't know how, you don't know why. It's a bit like this, and this is a case in point. So I can prove mathematically that this is what happens, but I don't have a good explanation.
All right, now it's your turn.
The thing with the spinning tubes,
yes.
The cylinders, does that depend on the two colored areas being on the same side of the cylinder?
The question is, when we did the tube experiment, this is quite popular, huh? Does it depend on the fact that I colored the tube on the same side? For example, what happens if I color here and then color underneath and so on? No, it does not matter. Wherever you color, it's going to be the same. And in fact, what you will see, sorry, this can be removed, is that you see this, if you color on the other side or something like that, those cycloids will be shifted a little bit, half a period. And then instead of going puff, puff, puff here, it will go puff, puff, puff here, and that's all it. So what you see will be the same pattern, but the whole thing will be a little shifted, but which will not be noticeable anyway. But excellent question.
Keeping with this problem, what if you start the spinning by tweaking it like that, and then you take the disc away, the table away, and instantly take gravity away too? Yeah. What would happen?
Interesting. The question is, what happens if we start the motion, or suppose the motion is going, this spinning tube, but suddenly you say kazam, and then you make the table disappear, the room disappear, the gravity disappear, but you are still there. And then you watch. Then what happens is the inertial motion. So what happens is exactly the same as if you are, say, attach a stone at the end of a string and you sort of swivel around. Or a stone makes a circular motion. But then you see what the stone is trying to do is it really wants to, in the absence of all constraints, it wants to just fly straight. But it cannot because I'm sort of pulling it in at all times with a string. So when in the course of doing this, you say kazam and make everything disappear except the stone and the observers, stone at that point will fly off in the direction tangent to that circle at that point. And that's what happens. And here also, if you make there are a lot of forces coming in from the floor which is supporting, and the rotation, the rolling, actually has a very interesting contact condition which is making all of this happen. So if you just say kazam, well, this tube will keep the spin that it had, but then fly off in the direction that it was moving at that moment in time, and then it's a sort of tumble motion and go off. That's what you do.
I have a question.
Yes.
I wonder, how do you find out about these toys? Was it just happen accidentally, or you really were like studying about it?
The question is, how do I find these toys? Excellent question. I wish I knew. As you saw, some of those toys were found by other people, really imaginative, wonderful scientists. Others were found by me. I find them, a little bit of historical background, if I may. Maybe it's not going to answer the question. When I used to be an artist and then a classical linguist. And in my 20s, I decided to try mathematics. I already had a job as a classicist. So I tried, and then I did a PhD, orange and black. But I started in a fairly, shall I say, abstract, what people might call pure part of mathematics. Although nowadays, I'm not sure about this pure applied distinction is that useful. But anyway, so in an area called topology. And then I had a program of my own, so I started doing physics. I had to teach myself physics. I had wonderful friends like Vijay Balasubramanian and Juan Madacena who taught me physics, helped me to learn physics. And then, you know, I started playing with physics, more applied subjects, let's say. And then I realized, you see, while I was doing very pure mathematics, I couldn't share any of it with friends and family who are not scientists, who are not mathematicians. But now, because these are really tangible objects, I had an opportunity. So I decided that every time I figured out something or I finished a project, I would design something that even partially modestly captures some of the weirdness, if you like, or the fun that I had in that project. And then, of course, it was popular, and I started going the other way around. Now I look around, and I realize that, in fact, the world is, the universe is full of science and little surprises, scientific surprises, waiting to be picked up. And these are the toys. And so I really would like to sort of encourage you to look around. It does take some patience, and it helps if you have some technical skills. But nonetheless, really the first point is, you see, if I may, I'm sorry that this answer is becoming very long. But sometimes when I do this, people say, and very well-meaning people say, well, it's very wonderful because you take difficult science and make it simple for the general public. And that's exactly what I'm trying not to do. You see, because it sounds like we are the guardians of this scientific temple, and you know, you hoi polloi don't understand any of this, so I'm going to make it dumb it down. But that's exactly what I'm not doing. What we are doing is that we try to find genuine surprises, things that are surprising and amusing for non-scientists, but also professional researchers alike. Okay, once they see the surprise, professional researchers having a lot of technical baggage might go faster in understanding this and might have more resources. But nonetheless, the initial surprise should be shared by everyone. And what I'm trying to say is that all those surprises are actually abundant in the life around us. It takes only imagination and patience to pick them up.
I have a question pertaining to the knot with the tied strip of paper where you made a hex.
Yeah, heptagon, hexagon, heptagon and pentagon.
Yeah.
And
I'm interested in the one in the figure in the bottom where you tried to make a three-sided.
Yeah.
And I was playing with this strip of paper, mm-hmm. and I flipped it into a Mobius. And if you reduce the distance, it kind of does it. I don't understand what's happening, but maybe you could help.
So the question is, how do you make an equilateral triangle? And it's quite interesting. The way I'm suggesting there is you take a strip of paper, and do you remember this weird remark that, well, in order to make a three-gon, you should make a knot with zero pass. What is a knot with zero pass? Well, I started making a knot, but then I decide not to make a knot. Okay? And then, so you see, when I do this, I can align this bit, and I can align this bit, and I can just adjust those two bits, just alignment, and then just squash. So this is a knot with zero pass, and in the middle, you see there's an equilateral triangle. What the gentleman is saying is that if instead you go this way, and then you keep proceeding kind of symmetrically, you end up at the flattened version of something called Mobius strip, and that works too. But it's interesting to explore, and this is a great opportunity for me to say, you should explore systematically, sort of clean up the subject, and have that as part of your own science.
All right, well, that's all for tonight, but we hope we'll see you next month.